In the transition between the 20th and 21st centuries, a heated debate developed about the authorship of a newly discovered poem, a funeral elegy. Initially, by Professor Donald Foster's postulated author candidate, William Shakespeare, was later rejected, based on textual and linguistic criteria, in favor of a contemporaneous author of Shakespeare, John Ford. For more details, see links above. If it was not Shakespeare, but a less well-known contemporary of Shakespeare, John Ford, you may ask yourself, who on earth is this poet? Since virtually no reliable early biographical information on John Ford does exist, the only possible way should be to extract some autobiographical information from his early literary prose and poetical texts, beyond his later dramatical works, such as A. Christ's Bloody Sweat, or The Son of God in His Agony, B. The Golden Meane, discoursing the nobleness of perfect virtue in extremes, and C. A Line of Life, pointing at the immortality of a virtuous name. Let's begin, and contemplate, at first, five consecutive poems out of Ford's opus Christ's Bloody Sweat, or The Son of God in His Agony, printed in 1613. Christ's Bloody Sweat can be regarded as an allegorical poem, dealing superficially with the passion of Christ, but in a subtle, profoundly enigmatical way with the passion and destiny of another Christ, that is Christ au fair Marlowe, the true Shakespeare. This assumption supports the view that the suspected author, John Ford, belongs to the multiple Penames of the true Shakespeare. Let's try to convince you with five consecutive poems out of the poetical allegory Christ's Bloody Sweat. The 315 poems are artistically backed with marginalia from the Holy Scripture, so that there should be no doubt that all sentences represent an interpretation taken out of the Bible. This is, however, neither tenable nor credible, since the text is in an autobiographical first-person form. The author places his own personal suffering on the same level as Christ. Who else, but the true Shakespeare, Christopher Marlowe, dared to assume such a presumptuous attitude? For whiles in compass, in a fleshly frame, in a cloud of dark mortality, I lived the subject, both of scorn and shame, banished from mirth, of comforts all deprived, horrors with scandal, cares with cares did strive, and ever as I lived, I died alive. Tears in my eyes, division in my heart, disgrace upon my name, plaints in my breast, thirst in my sufferance, hunger in my smart, naked and cold, imprisoned and oppressed, troubled within, tempted without, my head uncertain where to lead me, to my bed. Poor and forsaken, every day in danger of wrath and treason, lesser price than dust, of all, abhorred, even to mine own a stranger, no man my friend, in any friend no trust, my miracles termed devilish, and my prayer hypocrisy, my sorrows hell displayer. This entertainment in the world, I had, yet, for the world, exposed myself, to all more than this, though this be all too sad, but here too, did my father's will me call, which most above the rest his with pain, did cleave my soul, all woe began in twain. The charge of whose hot wrath so fearful was, as against nature, changed my sweat to blood, which trickling down my cheeks upon the grass, well old the agony wherein I stood, an agony indeed, whose trembling heat, powered out the wonder of a bloody sweat. These five consecutive stanzas of John Ford, with their autobiographic statements, which equal a blueprint of Marlowe's fate, suffice to recognize Marlowe directly as the true author. Be fully aware that John Ford's opus, Christ's Bloody Sweat, is strongly reminiscent of Giles Fletcher's opus, Christ's Victory, Over and After Death. At the end of the epistle to the reader, the author reveals explicitly and stunningly, "Let all the arts bestow upon us this gift, that we be not thought dead men, whilst we remain among the living." Also, John Ford's prose essay, The Golden Meane, deals superficially with moral concepts of how to attain the peace of mind, but profoundly and autobiographically, with six specific miseries a nobleman can befall. That is, which Marlowe had befallen. 1. Disfavor. 2. Neglect. 3. Forfeit of estate. 4. Banishment. 5. Imprisonment and 6. Death. How should one assess the fact that John Ford deals with the problem of banishment in 20 pages of his tract The Golden Meane, without making an autobiographical connection here? But even when the author deals with death, we learn about him that he did fitly feign death, to be the child of the night and sleep, to be the sister of death. Wisely including that as night and sleep wrap up all in stillness, so should death more perfectly finish the course of evils by burying them in a grave, never to arise. Thank you. Shakespeare expert. Professor Kenneth Muir quoted from Ford, The Line of Life, that he was tempted to find the center of his persona by showing that the true glory of this virtuous man survived the disaster of his life. Howsoever he, Ford, live, sequestered from commerce by the injustice of a prevailing enemy, or shut up in prison by the suggestion of nimble information, or disgraced by the credulous confidence of misinformed majesty, or despised by the many-tongued malice of the abused multitude, or impoverished by the oppression of an ever-begging, but never satisfied, flattery, or defamed by the graceless rumor of scandal, or traduced by the puzzling deceit and snare of smooth imposture, or put to death by the importunity of the faulty. According to Kenneth Muir, the core of John Ford's philosophy of life, he was more certain of the disasters than of the richest chain wherewith a good man can be adorned, namely the Milky Way of immortality and his name on earth. John Ford, in A Line of Life, written in 1620, years before the appearance of the first folio, stunningly reveals that he could not choose, in his lifetime, but build a monument, to which the triumph of his memory shall give a longer life than the perpetuity of stone and marble. These sentences don't make the slightest sense for John Ford, but everyone, for the true Shakespeare. Wow! The true Shakespeare, Marlowe alias Ford, is announcing, in 1620, the upcoming erection of his Stratford Monument. The penultimate video discussed the bizarre history of authorship debate of a funeral elegy between two Shakespeare experts, Foster and Montserrat. And that, it must have been written by the true Shakespeare, identical with one of his many pen names, John Ford. This present video irrefutably indicates that John Ford must have been a pseudonym or pen name, identical to Marlowe, the true Shakespeare. Based on the analysis of Ford's A. Christ's Bloody Sweat, B. His Golden Meane, and C. A Line of Life.